I am Tidiwa Rabila. This is the book feature of the Imperative magazine. I am joined by the lovely Bafana Yandeni, who grew up in the rough conditions of Hlalane Kahle in Emalahleni. Bafana takes us through the pain, the laughter, the joy that he experienced in his family while growing up. He also takes us into the family betrayals where his mother was expected to stand and support everyone, but when it was time for her to be supported, there was absolutely no one in her corner. He takes us through the journey of him wanting to be his mother's support, his mother's aid, and how he saw his mother's side fading from partialness into complete blindness. It is a story of pain, laughter, but it's a story that you and I can take into our own lives. And I promise you, there is one poem that you can take, frame it for yourself, for your mother, or for anyone who represents the process of motherhood in your life. Enjoy.
Hi everyone, my name is Tidiwa Rabila and this is the book review feature on the Imperative Online magazine, and today's book author is Bafana Yandeni. I had to practice that, right? Did I get it right?
No, you got it right.
I perfect, did. Perfect. So, in the Imperative community, we believe that we are all on the journey. We're journeying with something in us. There's gifts and there's magnificent, amazing light that the universe gives us. We unleash that either by writing a book, by the songs, by many other things. So yours, we believe that is through the book. And today you'll take us through that process that led you into, you know, writing that book or this book. But before we get that, so this is a book that is dedicated, a collection of poems dedicated to your late mother.
Yes, it
is. Who is your late mother?
Her name was Claudia Matebula.
Yeah.
She was the greatest person I've ever met. So
yeah.
In dedication to her life, I decided to dedicate her life through writing, through poetry.
Yeah.
So that's how I paid homage to her, to the life that she lived.
You grew up, where did you grow up?
Woodbank, Emalahleni.
Emalahleni.
Yeah, in the township called Lisnambi, Hlalane Kahle.
Hlalane Kahle. Yes. Is that the name of the township?
That's the name of the
I've
township.
I've never heard that. So yeah, in Hlalane Kahle, you live like any other person in the township. How many are you at home?
It was my mom, my dad, and my younger sister.
So what's the day like? What's the day to day like?
It was rough growing up in Hlalane Kahle. I don't want to lie.
Yeah.
When people say they are from humble beginnings, those were actual humble beginnings. We were very poor. My mom had lost her eyesight, so the only person who was really working was my dad.
Okay. So was she partially blind or was she blind?
When I was born, she was partially blind. Okay. She lost her eyesight when I was 12, completely.
Okay.
So she went completely blind when I was 12 years old. So my life was with her, stay-at-home mom. She would cook, clean.
So she was able to do
she still did all of those things. And then my dad would go. My dad was a bricklayer.
Okay, yeah.
So, so the life was just us with my mom in the house while my dad was away. So that's basically what the day-to-day was.
But what do you remember about, you know, going home after school or before school? So for me, my mom worked in the kitchens, what we call the kitchens that time in Pretoria while we were in Mahulereng. But I remember when she was around, she would make the best fat cakes ever.
Wow.
So when she was home, at any given day, I'll come back. When I was coming back from school, I was looking forward to those fat cakes. So for you, what is it that you came home through the poverty, in the poverty, that you look forward to?
Oh, it's funny you say that your mom made fat cakes, because my mom made fat cakes for a living.
Yeah.
So she would bake fat cakes and then we would sell them in the morning before we went to school. She'd bake batches that we would then have to go house to house.
Wow,
before school.
Yeah. Okay.
Then after school, I know it was either dumpling waiting or the leftover fat cakes that we did.
Nice.
And I knew we'd find her either cooking or cleaning, still cleaning, because we came back at around 3
okay.
from school. So
all right.
She was always there. That was that's what the nicest part.
That was the nicest part. So what was so fond about her that when she left, you wanted to translate into this book?
Her presence was my peace.
Yeah.
Just a comfort, knowing when she was around, you wouldn't didn't need to say anything with her. Just
yeah.
with her being there, you felt this great peace that was over you. So
yeah.
even when I went to visit,
yeah.
one thing I looked forward to was just being at home and sitting with her, not even saying words, just
yeah.
her presence
yeah.
alone was comforting enough for me.
Wow.
So it was that's one thing that I missed immediately when she passed.
When she passed,
yeah.
yeah.
The comfort and that peace that
yeah.
her presence
yeah.
gave me.
Yeah. yeah. So I want to, you will take me through into what was happening for you, right? But then I find this very it's a beautiful, you know, poem
yeah.
which I will read when we come back from the break. But it's something so every one of us, as we're growing up, we experience, and it's called boiling point. So I want to go through that, and then you'll tell me what this means or what this meant for you when you were writing it. So when we come back from the break, I'll take you through boiling point.
Stay listening to the book feature as Bafana takes us into the boiling point. What is the boiling point, and how did that come about in his life? What lessons did he take, and what lessons is he leaving us with? Bafana also takes us into how he discarded God through the process when he lost his mother, and when he saw his mother suffering, and when he questioned, is there God? He takes us into a full circle when now he is a fully committed Christian and he's found his faith again. It's a beautiful story, and I know you want to stay listening.
So Bafana, as I promised, that when you come back, I'm going to read Boiling Point. Mama, I can reach the pot now. My little feet gained an inch, tall enough to scratch that which itches. No need for a footstool. My feet can stand on their own, long enough for me to reach. Every ail that was once a thorny bridge between me and your aid, this time with ease, just a stretch of my hand, and I am there, holding the hot end by which your palm gained its bend.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful, you know, it's a beautiful narration of a growing point, which, I mean, at some point our mothers were this, you know, the aid between us and the pot and
yeah.
the doors. And so when I was reading the poem, I'm thinking, wow, it's something so profound that they did. You know, when you're walking and you're about to fall, and then
yeah.
there'll be that catch.
Yeah.
And this poem for me brought it up, like, and I couldn't, you know, I was just going, wow, wow. So what made you, you know, jot this down to the level that you did?
I think growing up, seeing my mom do the things she did, the one thing I always wanted to do was to be her helper, the way she helps everyone else. So, and when I was young, I couldn't really wash the dishes unless I'm on something, or I couldn't really cook the
yeah.
way she cooks because I'm still too young.
Okay.
So the day she gave me the opportunity to actually help her or move the boiling pots from the side so she can cook, that was that day.
Wow.
Then, this day. So I thought it was a great memory because I felt like, okay, now I'm on my way to doing the things that I always wish for.
Okay.
So that's
okay.
why I that
so that's why you wrote that part.
Yeah.
yeah. yeah. Okay.
But then I'm not sure if you're gonna read it. It was not as glorious as it was, because at the end the pot actually
I see that, because at the last part, because we won't read all the poems,
yeah.
you need to go buy the book, right? And this is the book. It's called Mama, a Collection of Her Poems, and it is by Bafana Nyandeni, as I said. So I read that part, and then I'm gonna go into the last part where it said, Mama, I failed you. Every bubbled scar is a reminder of the one miss pa by which I failed, no less than all those who claimed a love veiled. I scared the one that was love.
So, Mama,
I failed you. What happened there?
When the pot fell, because when I tried to move it fell.
Yeah.
I was still young. My hands were still young.
Wow, how old were you?
I think I was 12.
You remember?
Yeah, 12.
Yeah.
yeah. So I was still young. So when it fell on her, because it fell on her, it didn't just fall, so it fell on her. So I was so scared. And I felt like I'm disappointing her the way I felt the world disappointed her too. So that's why I said I failed you, not just in my cooking, but I failed you in being a son and being a helper to you.
Wow. So did it burn her? Did she?
Yes, yes. But it was minor burns.
Okay, yeah.
My dad came and he rushed. We called the ambulance. Yeah. It was just minor burns. There was nothing major. But I was still scared.
What in you felt like the world failed her?
It was, she was always, especially with her family from her father's side.
Yeah.
She was always the one that was helping everyone.
Okay.
But without any reparations. When it was her turn to be helped, no one wanted to help
her. Okay.
And also with my dad, there were some issues with my dad too. Because I feel like when I say those who promised a love veiled, that part was especially for my dad, because he's the one who married her and he's the one who took her in. But I still felt like he was not living up to the promises he had made to her. So.
What you're saying, whenever I find out, is so profound, because you're saying he's the one who married her.
Yeah.
He's the one who took her in. Yeah. I mean, and by that, which you're saying, and many of us who are married or in the institution of marriage or any relationship where we don't understand that by taking a vow to live with someone means that you're standing by the institution with its imperfection.
Mm.
And so this sentence or this poem is... it's a reminder to humanity and to everyone else that when you stand by something, you need to stand by it in its totality. And also for you as a 12-year-old boy who's able to see it, but the parents are not sometimes thinking that, you know, the kids can see.
Yeah.
So were you seeing that your mom needed more support, or and he was not supporting her enough? Or
what? Yes, that's how I felt. I felt like she needed more support. And there's also another one in there, because I've seen them fight.
Okay.
So those fights, like when they had arguments, and then my mom would leave the house.
Yeah.
But my dad, missing my dad not following her or not trying to comfort her, for me as a 12-year-old, it means he doesn't care.
Okay.
So as a child, it means he doesn't care enough to go after her. He doesn't care enough to wipe her tears.
Yeah.
So he must be failing.
Yeah.
Whatever promise he made.
Okay. So for you that day, when you were able to reach the point, you were saying, I'm now able to help you.
Yes.
I'm now able to support you. But then I, the very person who thinks that can support you, failing you in this.
Yes.
How did you at some point forgive the 12-year-old boy who dropped the pot?
Yes, I think I did. My mom made it easy for me too.
Yeah.
Because the very next day she laughed about it.
Yeah.
And then she again showed me how to hold the
pot. Oh, so Nancy, we wish it.
Yeah, I know.
I was suddenly turning up.
My mom was never there.
Yeah, yeah. So she gave you so she showed you how to forgive yourself and to accept
before you. I could even try to forgive myself. So she showed me how to do it properly.
Yeah.
And then I never dropped it again after that.
If
she had just done the other and told me never to do it, or she I don't think I would have forgiven myself up to this point.
Yeah. So there's another poem that I want to go into, which is Rose. Roses. Is it Rose or Roses?
Roses.
Roses.
The second one.
The second one, right? So, yeah. So, I will read a bit because you still need to go get the book. So, the other one that I want us to read is Roses. In her hands I lay, clenching tight to the dreams she borrows me. In her arms I rest, sulking life from the fountain of her bosom. With each sip introducing new promises of love unknown to me. I am home, yet undefined. In her arms I find solace, and her scent covers all that I am to become. Like the perfect cocoon, it becomes all that I know and all that my nostrils will accept. Wow.
Yeah.
What? That is such a beautiful poem.
No, thank you.
Which I will go on and frame it to my mother, because I don't know anyone who can unpack the mystery of motherhood and of nurturing motherhood. And only you and people who are special enough that the universe have chosen to be the vessel of that message can do that. And some of us will sit in envy because we'll never have those words to to share with our mother, can only ask how you managed to unpack that.
Yeah, no, it goes back to the comfort thing.
Yeah,
because this one is basically me trying to relive how it felt when she'd still be holding me on her arms when I was still young.
Yeah.
So because of the comforts I felt growing up, I felt like it must have come from just me being still like an infant.
Yeah.
So, and knowing that a baby would familiarize himself with his mother with the sense.
Yeah.
Just the sense alone.
Just the sense alone.
So from that sense alone, I put that comfort that I've experienced with the way I've seen my mom even deal with her own grandchildren.
Yeah.
So that for me, it made me relive that moment.
That
as an
moment.
Infant.
Yeah, that was beautiful. Thank you. So after the break, when we come back, I want to know what in you, right? You wrote the book, but then you must know that in order for you to write this kind of a book with this message, there's something in you, universal or godly, that wrote the book. So what in you wrote the book, and what message do you have for the young Bafana who's attempting to put something down and wanting to write something this magnificent? So all of that after the break. Welcome back. My name is Sili Warapila, and this is the book feature on the Imperative Online Magazine. And today I am seated with none other Bafana Nyanleni. Bafana comes all the way from Emalahleni. He's taken us through where he comes from as a young boy who grew up in the eyes of poverty, as a young boy who saw the pain there the unraveling that his mother had to do with, had to go through with a partial sight and ultimately with her sight, you know, going completely blind. What you wanted to be for her, and at some point as a 12-year-old thinking that you're not, right?
Yeah.
So, and we read two poems from your book, The One Roses, which is my ultimate favorite. And I believe that everybody must write that book, must get that poem, frame it up and give it to someone whom you love dearly, to your mother or to anyone who you think represents that, or read it for yourself as an honor to your mother. And we also read another beautiful one, which is Boiling Point, which talks about the little mistakes or the little engagement that we children have with our parents. So what in you wrote the book?
I'd say, okay, growing up, the one thing my mother had was faith.
Okay.
In God. So she that's the one thing she taught us as a children. And so even when she lost the eyesight, I was the one who went with her to church. I had to accompany her to church. So that that faith also had an impact in me.
Mm.
So when she passed, I started struggling with the idea of there being a God.
Yeah.
And if there was a God, why did she struggle so much
yeah.
and still die
yeah.
at the very final days?
Yeah.
Because she died on my graduation year. So the year she died, that was when I was graduating from Valley.
So she didn't see you graduate.
No, so she didn't see me graduate. So
yeah.
for that whole year. Now I was struggling to reconcile that with an existing,
because you're thinking, God, you should have carried her to see this honor, right? You should have carried her to see this glory, and you didn't.
All her hard work,
yeah,
and then he didn't. So I felt betrayed,
yeah.
So for that
by
whole
God.
Year, yes, by God,
yeah.
So
yeah.
For that whole year, I shunned God,
yeah,
but then. In that shining of God, I was not healing because I was keeping all the feelings bottled up in me.
Yeah.
Until I picked up the pen and I wrote the first poem of the book.
Yeah.
So for me, the book became a way for me to heal.
But so this is you, where you shine in the emotions and you're trying to reconcile her life with what you thought could have been the gift of her life, you graduating, and that doesn't happen, right? So what you then take a pen and then you're writing, but what nudged you? You know, that must have been a process. What then said to you, take a pen and put all of your emotions on paper?
I think it was a way for me to ultimately go back to God. I think it was for me, because now I'm back to being a believer. I'm a faith-based person.
Mm.
So for me, it was God calling me to say, this is your healing.
Mm.
Your healing is here. Because I didn't want to believe it.
Mm.
I didn't want to speak up out about it until I believed that the writing would bring me healing. I didn't think that just me writing that will turn into a book.
So would you say when you were writing, where you just want to write the emotions until ultimately it got into the book?
Until ultimately it became all these different emotions started forming a pattern.
Okay.
And that's when I went back to now reliving my life with her. Instead of blaming God and blaming my mom for leaving too soon or blaming myself for failing her, I started reliving every moment that made me love her and made her love me.
So you celebrated her life instead of going into why and how and what we believe or what you believe should have been, so you went and said, okay, so it happened, how do I celebrate it? Because there was still a human being in her, and for me to heal is to celebrate that human being in her.
Yes, exactly. That's how I saw it, and then ultimately that's what happened.
Yeah.
Even when I wrote the final part, which is me accepting her death.
Okay.
The final poem is basically me accepting her death.
Wow.
After that, it was...
So is it the final poem?
Yes, it's the
final
poem.
Okay, I'm going to do the final poem with you, because that's the last.
Yes.
This is...
Rest easy. Yes.
Rest easy. The tear duct finally gave in, letting out all imprisoned emotions, shackles in between cages in fagin concern. Once trapped behind facades of strength and uncaring, in the shades of those offering shoulders, as collection plates for all my tears to soothe the residual pain picking through my iris. Rain clouds finally gave out, teardrops of dismay disguised in disbelief, each failing drop held in between streams, a dream delayed and deterred, dreamt in response to love unwarranted, given wholeheartedly. Wow. So that was the last poem, and where you felt like, did you literally feel the rain? Did you literally cry it out?
Yes, I did. I actually cried it out before I wrote that poem. So after crying it out, I actually felt a huge weight being lifted off my shoulders.
That's beautiful, Bafana. So this, in this book, this is like your healing piece, right? Is it what lesson do you want people who are watching us today, what lessons do you want them to get out of this book?
Basically, this book is dedicated to living mothers.
Okay.
Because I've seen that a lot of women who are mothers, especially in townships, and who are mothers to black kids, have to go through a lot of things that are not really on the spotlight, that are not put on the spotlight.
Mm.
Sometimes we even celebrate all their sacrifices without knowing how much they had
they
to give
really
up.
They really have to give up,
So that's who I dedicated this book to say, to all our mothers, to say we understand, we know that you've turned so much just for us, and we pray that you even if it's not, because what we can give you is not enough, but may the little that we do to pay you back, at least feel like it can hold that hole that was created in you sacrificing for us.
Basically that's
the message.
That's a beautiful message. So to someone who is Ebafana, somewhere out in Emalahleni or Mahwelereng or whatever, who is attempting or wanting to write a book, what message do you have for them?
One thing I would say is look within yourself.
Like,
trust whatever instincts are in you, so, and then put them out.
Yeah.
Don't worry about publishing. Don't worry about how people will receive it. As long as it's on paper, that's how you will receive it. The way you will receive it will be on paper. And then from there, you can go on. As long
so
as
let the universe or let God deal with the how.
Yes.
Yeah.
You do with the now, what you can do with it.
Yeah.
If you have the gift, if you've been given the gift, your job is to just put it down.
Yeah. And that's amazing. That's amazing. So how do we get the book?
The book now, it's mainly door to door, but I have it on at Bridge Books, Mabonengi and Jersey CBD.
Okay.
But if you want it, you can contact me on my socials. At Nyandini Bafana Twitter and the Bafana Nyandini on Facebook.
On Facebook. So that's how we can make an order. And do you distribute around national or where do you distribute? Do you distribute national as well? And are you going to write any more books?
Yes, I'm writing.
Or does it depend on will it be circumstantial or are you intentional about writing the next one?
No, now I'm intentional.
Okay. And do you want to tell us what it is?
I just actually did release the free PDF just of a collection of poems I did last month.
Okay,
just for my readers to say thank you.
Okay.
And then I'm writing a novel right now. So.
Oh, wow. Okay, a novel coming. You had it right here. And we're going to have you, obviously, on the book feature of the Imperative Online Magazine. Bafana, you are amazing. And thank you for sharing this beautiful and loving message. I promise you, when I read this, when I read the poems, these are... it's loving, it's painful, it's reveling, but ultimately it's there's, you know, everyone will get something out of it. And from me to you, cheers.
Thank you.
Thank you.